Well, welcome and God bless you. My name is Paul Berry. I'm the senior pastor of Calvary Chapel, Santa Maria. I believe this is a unique opportunity for us on cable access TV to bring you segments of our regular services here. A service that is going to include not only the Word of God, line by line, precept by precept, but also that Word in the power of the Holy Ghost to change your life, even as I've seen it change so many people's lives in our congregation. I believe the Word of God has a unique power, a power that's far beyond the ability of speakers or churches that can affect your life, change your life. Romans 10 verse 17 says, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. So as you listen to the Word of God this morning, in the power of the Holy Spirit, let it change you, let it change your neighborhood, let it change the place in which you work, let it change your family, let it change the things that the Lord wants you to occupy until He is the bridegroom, comes for His blessed bride, the church. And I pray that that's soon. God bless you. I'll just take you back quickly to kind of set the scene with respect to the 15th verse in Matthew 24. See, Jesus there says to His disciples, listen, you need to know about an event that in fact is mentioned three times in the book of Daniel. That event in Matthew 24, verse 15, is the abomination of desolation. Well, let's look at Daniel 9, verse 27. This is where that specific term, it's used two other times in Daniel, but this is really the most important point. Daniel 9, 27, when Daniel writes, then he, this is the Antichrist, shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week. 1 week of years, that's 7 years. Friends, don't let people tell you that the tribulation is only 3.5 years. Daniel has prophesied that it is 7 years, a week of years. But he divides it into two halves. He says, in the middle of those 7 years of tribulation, he, the Antichrist, shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering. And on the wing of abomination shall be one who makes desolate, even until the consummation which is determined is poured out on the desolate. Now the desolate are those that follow the Antichrist. The desolate are those that from about Revelation chapter 13 and on, take the mark of the beast. And this is something that is going to be compelled upon all people in those days, because in the middle of this 7 years, as Daniel says in verse 27, the Antichrist is in fact going to call himself God. He's going to stand in the holy place of the temple and he's going to call himself God. And beyond that, force at sword point, gun point, whatever point it is, all people that are living in those days to take not only a mark upon them, but to worship him in consecration. Now that's a tough thing because, of course, Christians and Jews will worship no other God but the living God, the God of Israel. And listen, I don't know how the Antichrist is going to be able to confirm this covenant, which we now understand must be a covenant between the Muslims and the Jews. Why do we say that? Because there has to be a temple on the Temple Mount for Jesus to return. When will this temple be built? We're not sure, but it will be because of a peace covenant Daniel describes and Jesus will later describe, John describes in Revelation, a peace covenant between now what we understand are the Muslims and the Jews. Because today, this very day, the Temple Mount, the Al-Aqsa Mosque, the El-Sharif Mosque, these mosques are dedicated to the religion of Islam. Now, in fact, Israel has military control over all the city of Jerusalem. But they have, in a sense, handed over the control of the Temple Mount to the Muslims, and here's why. Jews are concerned about going up on the Temple Mount and standing on the spot where the Holy of Holies once was. Their faith dictates that they shall not approach the presence of God, but only through a priest. So they don't go up there. And when we come to Jerusalem on our yearly study tours, we always go up on the Temple Mount. It always is very early in the morning, has to be between 7 a.m. and 10 a.m. And when you enter the Temple Mount, you discover, first of all, that you're being watched very closely. Every woman's garb is inspected to make sure that it is modest in the sense that they require modesty. And instructions are given to the group that you shall not touch any person. Husbands can't hold wives' hands. No touching, no Bible reading, no singing, no worship. Quietness is what they require, and no expression of Judaism or Christianity. But you know what? It's still worth going up there, because you get to see the very pavement on which Jesus once stood. You stand in the place where great men of God's word have once stood and adored the God of Israel, have worshiped him in spirit and in truth. At the southern steps of the Temple Mount, as we walk up those steps, we remember, as we stand on those steps, those are the very steps that Jesus once stood on. Those are the steps that the apostles, the disciples, these are the steps that Solomon, Isaiah, Jeremiah, these are the steps that the great men and women of Scripture once stood on. And I'll tell you, it's pretty exciting, I got to say. Can't say hallelujah up on the Temple Mount, but I'm going to shout it to hallelujah on the southern steps, because it's that essential. I mean, it's like, I'll never forget where I'm standing right now. We sit on those steps as I bring the people a study out of Psalm 24, interestingly enough. And we talk about what it means to walk up these steps to the house of God. To think in your mind, in Jeremiah's mind, in Isaiah's mind, walking up these steps, approaching the house where the Lord God, creator of this universe, sits upon his throne in the Holy of Holies. I don't know if that affects you, but it levels me. It really does. And it's with that respect that the Jews will not go up on the Temple Mount. They'll come on the southern steps, but they won't go up on the Temple Mount. And you find a lot of Muslims, because there's two major mosques up on the Temple Mount. El Sharif, which is the Dome of the Rock, and then there's the Al-Aqsa Mosque as well. Very important to them also. But I say all these things because the Antichrist is going to have to figure out a covenant between Israel and the Muslims so that a temple can be built in some manner, some conjunction with the Dome of the Rock up on that Temple Mount. Because we know Ezekiel's temple must exist when Jesus returns to Jerusalem. Now, this covenant that is divided into two sections of 42 months, two sections of 1,260 days, these two sections are divided into by what Jesus and Daniel call the abomination that brings desolation. And that abomination is any man calling himself God, whether he be possessed by the devil or not. No man can call himself God. God's not going to put up with it. But the populace of the world sucks it in. They eat it up. They're taking it in. Yes, amazing things that the Antichrist is allowed to do by the power of Lucifer himself. He makes statues talk and walk. He makes fire come down from heaven. And who wouldn't? I mean, you know, I don't know if you've been to the recent rock concerts, but I guess these kind of things happen quite often. We're all being prepared for the certain possibility that, of course, this could happen. We would expect that at any Aerosmith concert or this concert here in this new temple. Well, Jeremiah tells us that this 7-year period in Jeremiah 30, verse 7, is the time of Jacob's trouble. Jacob, of course, being Israel. Jacob's trouble, a time of trouble intended to bring the hearts of the nation of Israel back to the God of Israel. Listen, at this point, God is no respecter of any person. There is a preferred, I think, position for today's Jews, but no preference to heaven outside of the way, the truth, and the life of Jesus himself. Well, Jesus moves in verse 16 through 20 from general remarks to very specific remarks with respect to what it's going to be like in the second half of the tribulation for Jews and Christians. Now, first of all, because it's an abomination that brings desolation upon this world, we know that Lucifer is going to be cast from heaven and is going to walk on this earth. I don't think he does right now, because Revelation chapter 12 describes him as being in the presence of the Father, accusing the brethren day and night. He's got a job, and he's doing it quite well. He's got his little minions, his little demons down here doing a lot of his bidding, even as we have the blessed angels of God doing God's bidding. But we know three things about what this abomination is going to be like. First of all, it's going to be some kind of defiling, destructive event that happens in the temple itself. Secondly, it's going to happen in the holy place of the temple. Now, the holy place, the temple is divided into three rooms, in essence. And the holy place is that room which precedes before the Holy of Holies. Next, of course, the Antichrist will profess and confess himself to be God alone. You've been waiting for the Messiah? Well, here I am. And by the way, unless you take my mark, we'll kill you. Now, we're not going to say that to you today with respect to taking Jesus, but that's what the devil's going to say. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 4 says that this Antichrist who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, show that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Can you imagine the pride of someone to do such a thing? But that is the defining issue with respect to Lucifer himself. Verse 16 instructs his disciples, instructs even us today. I hope you see that there's a dual connection here. Listen, when the Romans come and they destroy this city, you need to run. Verse 16. All those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Now, Jerusalem surrounded by mountains. And in fact, history now tells us that when the Romans came, many Jews fleed? Can you use that word? Is that a real? No, it's not right. Flawed? Fled. I was close. Fled to northern Israel, Galilee, and even some fled across the Jordan to that wilderness sanctuary called Petra. Amazing place to go as well. Well, Jesus also says those that are on the housetop, don't even take the stairs down. Jump from the roof. Don't take anything out of your house. Those that are in the field, don't go back home to get your clothes. And the reason is, in Jesus' day, many of the people that worked in the field worked naked or worked with very little clothing because it would be very warm and a lot of sweat. Don't even go back home to get your clothes. Woe to those, verse 19, who are pregnant, and to those who are nursing babies in those days. No pregnant woman would run a marathon. I can hardly imagine a woman nursing a child being forced to run for her life. How difficult that would be. Jesus says, oh, woe to those. Woe to those that are pregnant or are nursing their children. And certainly that's going to be happening. Was happening when Rome came against Jerusalem. It's going to happen in the days when the Antichrist, in the mid part of that tribulation, begins to bring the sword against all those who refuse to take the mark of the beast. And I suspect every Jew will do that. I suspect every Christian saved during the tribulation would rather give their life than take the mark of that beast. Pray, he says in verse 20, pray that your flight may not be in winter or on the Sabbath. Isn't it interesting, as we'll see in verse 36, that Jesus is not referring to a specific day. Why wouldn't he say, well, I know it's not going to happen in winter, so take it easy. At least it'll happen in the fall, summer, or fall, or spring. No, Jesus says, well, I hope it doesn't happen in the winter. What Jesus is saying, listen, I don't even know when this is going to happen. But I know this, at the moment, like the Nehemiah event, the moment the Antichrist strikes this covenant with Islam and Jerusalem, from that moment, again, that great hourglass of God will turn. And there will be two exact periods of 42 months or 1,260 days. And it would seem as though from the very moment that hourglass or that declaration or that covenant of peace is signed, that people would know, gee, 1,260 days from now, an abominating, desolating event is going to occur in Jerusalem. And we better be prepared to run for our lives. We better be prepared to stand for Jesus even if it costs us our lives. Friends, I don't think Americans know what real religious persecution is like. You ask any Jew who knows any history with respect to his tribe, his race, his people, they will give you event after event after event in Israeli history where nations have come against them for the sole purpose of annihilating them completely. Of course, you remember in this last 100 years, not only World War I, but World War II, where the Third Reich, this confederacy of Germany and Italy and Japan, had one determined cause, and that was to annihilate the Jews. And it began by Jews having to register themselves in all the cities of Europe. Did you know that that's happening right now in the nation of Ukraine? Russia is requiring every Jew to register themselves as Jews in the Ukraine. Now, how can that lead to anything that's good? How can that lead to anything that's good? And why isn't America standing up against that and saying, we will not stand for another Holocaust? It's intriguing to me that even the Jews of America are not marching through the streets of New York with banners and saying, we've got to stop this. I'm wondering where the diplomacy of this nation is going. I tell you, friends, the devil hates the Jews, but I tell you, he hates you as well. I want to share with you quickly some comforts that come from Daniel as well. Daniel tells us that in the last days, we, the studiers of God's Word, will begin to understand prophecy like never before. We find this in Daniel chapter 12, verse 4. Daniel comforts us that suddenly the Word of God, with respect to its application to this day, is going to begin to just blossom and open itself to our understanding. Daniel says, but you, Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book until the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall increase. Now, Daniel, towards the end of chapter 12, confesses readily, I don't understand this stuff. But of course, Daniel would not, because it's not applicable to his time. But he recorded it under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Why? For you and I. Because we are in an age, dear friends, look closely, where many are running to and fro. Okay? I mean, the concept of driving 55 miles an hour in any kind of vehicle in Daniel's day or even Jesus' day, phenomenal. Wouldn't you say? I mean, 100 years ago, it was like, huh? How's that possible? People flying from nation to nation. People flying from Los Angeles 18 hours to Melbourne, Australia, without refueling or anything else. That's impossible. Yet, we are running to and fro in a manner and degree that is so modern, so beyond Daniel's understanding, even the disciples' understanding, that this must be pointing to this time. But look also, it says, knowledge shall increase. In the past 100 years, there have been more discoveries in science than almost all human history previous to that. We have increased in knowledge to a degree that's almost logarithmic. What is Daniel saying? In the days when people are able to move to and fro quickly, in the days when knowledge increases rapidly, know this, that the understanding of prophetic word in Scripture will blossom in the hearts of believers and will begin to understand and contemplate what Jesus, Daniel, and others are warning us of. The second comfort is this. Daniel tells us that those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life will be rescued from a time of trouble like none other. Well, Jesus says in Matthew 24, verse 21, that this is going to be a time, a period of 7 years, that has not been since the beginning of the world until this time, nor shall ever be. Horrifying events. Jeremiah, verse 7 of chapter 30 says, "Alas, for that day is great, so that none is like it." Daniel chapter 12, verse 1. "At the time Michael will stand up, the great prince who stands watch over the sons of your people, there will be a time of trouble," note this, "such as never was since there was a nation, even to that time." Trouble. But God's got a comforting promise to you. And if you'll go back to Daniel chapter 12, verse 1 with me, here's Daniel's comfort for you that's repeated in the New Testament as well. "And at that time," do you see that? "And at that time, your people shall be delivered, everyone who is found written in the book." But listen, friends, if your name isn't written in the Lamb's Book of Life, this time of trouble, this 7 years of tribulation, is going to be something you're going to live through. Now, you shouldn't get saved because you want to be saved from the tribulation. You should get saved because you understand that Jesus paid for your sins upon the cross. He who knew no sin became sin for you. And that sin died that late afternoon. And it was buried. It was put to death completely. And Jesus rose out of the power of the grave, the power of the cross, the power of sin. He overcame them all. And this is why Paul says twice in Romans chapter 10, "If you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ has risen from the dead," that's the pivotal point. Two of the guys died on the cross that day, so it isn't just that he died on the cross. Two of the guys at least were buried that day. It's not that they were buried on that day, but only one guy, one magnificent Savior of all mankind, rose from the dead on the third day as he prophesied. And that's our Savior. That's our Savior. And so we cling to him, don't we? We cling to his glory. We cling to his promise. And listen, if you don't have Jesus as your Savior, I beg of you today. I don't know when these things are going to happen. It seems as though a boss right now is refusing to meet with Netanyahu, even in the presence of John Kerry. In the Holocaust Remembrance Day that's coming up in Israel, it's interesting at least that Abbas said the Holocaust was horrible, because most Palestinians, most Muslims, negate the fact that the Holocaust ever occurred. So that's some consolation. But I want to say to you, it's going to take somebody that is way smarter, way more charismatic, way more persuasive than any potentate in this world today. And I believe the Antichrist is alive. I don't know where he is. I don't know what he's doing. But he is soon going to come on this scene. And Revelation chapter 6, verse 1 describes him as one who wears a crown, coming to conquer, conquering and to conquer. He's going to come to conquer and continue conquering all nations in this world, to the point in the midweek of those years that he will force all mankind to accept him as God. Can you imagine? Can you imagine any king, any president in any nation today saying, "I am God, come and worship me"? It's phenomenal. And yet those days are coming. I'm going to offer you the opportunity this morning to trust in Jesus as your Savior, to invite him to come and to cleanse you by the power of the blood of Jesus. The devil hates anyone mentioning the power of the blood of Jesus. But I mention it today because you know what? I hate the devil. I hate everything he stands for, and the lies and the pride that he attempts to persuade us with. Would you fight with me today? Christians, would you pray with me right now that those in our audience today that do not know Jesus as their Savior would give their hearts to him right now? Father, in Jesus' name, I plead that your throne would prevail in the hearts and minds of men and women this morning. We need more of the blood-bought, born-again, baptized believers in this world because they are the salt and they are the light. And we're invading the darkness and we're stopping the decay. And Father, if it be possible, I pray that your Holy Spirit is persuaded, some, perhaps even many this morning, to trust in Jesus as their Savior. If that be you, if you'd like to pray with me to receive Jesus as your Savior, to be cleansed and forgiven of all your sins, just where you're seated, you can pray this prayer out loud. And I want you to pray it out loud because I want your own ears to hear what your mouth is confessing. That's the importance there. So here's the prayer. Please pray after me, would you please? Father in heaven, I invite Jesus into my heart. Come, Jesus, with the power of your blood, and wash me of my sins. Cleanse me of all unrighteousness. Save me, Jesus, from myself, from this world. Save me from the devil. Save me, Jesus, from all that seeks to destroy me. I love you, Jesus. Now I know that you died for me. Now I know that your Spirit came to live in me. So come, Holy Spirit. Live in my heart. Speak through me. Put your power clothing upon me. And may I, for the first time in my life, live with the expectation of glory upon glory upon glory. As Phil Robertson would say, happy, happy, happy. Praise God for that. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, welcome to the family of Jesus Christ. Your name was just written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And we want you to come forward this morning and just speak with one of our elders, our pastors up front. They want to talk to you about what it means to be a member of the family of God. Have a wonderful Sunday. Have a wonderful week. May Jesus be glorified in your life. God bless you. You're dismissed. Well, I hope you enjoyed that broadcast. I pray that the Word of God affected your life and will go forth from your head to your heart and begin to affect your family, affect your neighborhood, affect your workplace. We welcome you to join us on Sunday mornings at 8:30 and 10:30, but only if you're not attending a church elsewhere in this community. I welcome you also to consider how the Lord would use you with this word and in His Spirit to do something eternal in these last days. God bless you. Once again, this is Paul Berry, Senior Pastor of Calvary Chapel.